Hello everyone. So today I'm going to discuss about the topic, that is the torch infection. First of all, why we are studying these infections? We are studying because these infections, like torch infections, they usually transfer from mother to the fetus. Like there is vertical transmission, or there is vaginal, or the transmission is during the vaginal delivery. So what does the torch stand for? So for the torch, T stands for the toxoplasma. O stands for others, like syphilis and varicella. All these include the others. Syphilis, varicella, all these come to this category. R stands for the rubella. C stands for the cytomegalovirus, and H stands for herpes. So these are the infections which comes under the torch infections, in which T stands for the toxoplasma, others like syphilis, like varicella, R stands for rubella, C stands for cytomegalovirus, and H for herpes virus. So these infections are transferred vertical transmission, or either there is vaginal delivery. So now let's take one by one all these torch infections. One more thing that we have to remember, that is like which infection is more during which trimester. Like there are three trimester: first, second, and third trimester. So in the first trimester, there is more increased risk of the rubella. Please remember, there is more increased risk of rubella virus, rubella infections. While in the second trimester, there is parvovirus B19, that is, and it is a most important cause for the non-immunohydrops fetalis. So parvovirus B19, which cause the hydrops fetalis. Now in the third trimester, includes the like toxoplasma, the cytomegalovirus, and the syphilis. All these comes under the third trimester, means there increased risk of infection in the third trimester. So here we have to remember, like first trimester, the risk is more for rubella virus. And out of all these torch infection, which infection is most common? We have one mnemonic, that C is for common, and C stands for cytomegalovirus. So this is the most common, cytomegalovirus, which is overall most common in the torch infection. Now first trimester, we have increased risk of rubella. Now let's discuss one by one. So first we are going to discuss about the toxoplasma. So congenital toxoplasma. So in congenital toxoplasma syndrome, what will happen? So in this, like as we know that toxoplasma, it's increased risk in the third trimester. So if it occurs, toxoplasmic infection occur in first trimester, then its chances were increasing in further trimester. Like in first trimester, if in percentage or risk of fetal infection is 15%, while in the third trimester it must be 60%. So that's why its transmission percentage will increase. In the third trimester, 60% chance of toxoplasmic infections. Now what triad comes under the toxoplasma? So we have triad for congenital toxoplasmosis. So congenital toxoplasmosis, we have triad. So here we have to remember that triad, in which it comes, first one is the hydrocephalus. First one is the hydrocephalus. Second one, there is a intracranial diffuse calcification. Will be there. While the third one, that one is the chorioretinitis. So for these infections, we must have one image memory. So as we see in this image here, the baby head size is enlarged. So it indicates that there is hydrocephalus is there. And in this image, we can see that there is intracranial calcification, like all these white dot which are seen in the CT scan of the brain. We see that there is calcification is there. So it is diffuse calcification as it spread across all the throughout the brain. That's why it is diffuse, and it is inside the brain. That why diffuse intracranial calcification. Now in the third image, as we see that there is chorioretinitis will be there. So in this there is chorioretinitis. So this is the triad for the toxoplasmosis. Please remember, we have a image based memory. So in that we have to imagine these three images. First one, a baby with a head enlarged, that is hydrocephalus. In the second one, we have intracranial calcification. Please remember, this is diffuse intracranial calcification. Calcification is all around the all inside the brain. And the third one, that is chorioretinitis. So this is a triad for the toxoplasma syndrome. Now what is the confirmatory test for the toxoplasma? So we have to remember the confirmatory test. So in the confirmatory test of this, we include the immunoglobulin M in the serum, IgM in the serum, and for this we have treatment, that is a pyrimethamine, or we can give sulfadiazine, or also we can give leucovirin. By this leucovirin, we have to treat the asymptomatic patient also. This is the remarkable line, that asymptomatic infant should be treated. Now how we can treat the a pregnant mother, how we can treat her? We can treat her by giving with spiromycin during the pregnancy, because this spiromycin will decrease the risk of transmission. So how we can decrease the risk of transmission in toxoplasma? So decrease risk of transmission in toxoplasma is with spiromycin, because it decreases the risk of transmission. We have to remember this point also. So all these are the important points which I cover in the toxoplasma. The first point, that it includes one triad, that is a hydrocephalus, intracranial calcification, and chorioretinitis. And toxoplasma, its highest increased risk in the third trimester. So for the confirmatory test, we have to do immunoglobulin serum in IgM in serum, we have to check it. And for the treatment, we have give pyrimethamine, sulfadiazine, or leucovirin. And for the toxoplasmosis, we have to treat the asymptomatic infant also. So asymptomatic infant should be treated for the toxoplasma. And for the decreasing risk of transmission, we can give the patient spiromycin. So spiromycin can decrease the risk of transmission. Now the next one, O stands for the others. In others, we have syphilis. So what we have to study in the syphilis? So in congenital syphilis syndrome, we have to know that syphilis is due to the treponema pallidum. And it's also increased risk in the third trimester. So it also increases in the risk in the third trimester. Now there is one question, previous year question, that what is the early manifestation of the syphilis? So what is early manifestation? So for the early manifestation of syphilis, we have to remember the snuffles. So please remember this snuffle. Why, how it differs? Because snuffle is more severe, it lasts longer, and also there is rhinitis is there, bloody rhinorrhea, bloody rhinorrhea will be there. So by these three way, it differs from the normal normal simple rhinitis, because this snuffle is more severe, it lasts longer, and it shows bloody rhinitis also, while in the simple rhinitis is just opposite. So that's how it differs. So the first manifestation, the early manifestation, is the snuffling will be there. Now what is the triad for the syphilis? We have to remember the triad. So for the triad, in the triad we have a Hutchinson triad. The name of the triad is Hutchinson triad. So what include the Hutchinson triad? So Hutchinson triad, it is basically a late manifestation. So in late manifestation, what we all see, we see that there is a Hutchinson teeth will be there. As we can see in this image, it look like Hutchinson, like this kind of teeth. So it's a Hutchinson teeth. There is like a second one, there is interstitial keratitis will be there. And the third one, that is the eighth nerve deafness will be there. So this include the Hutchinson triad, that is teeth, interstitial keratitis, and eighth cranial nerve deafness is there. In Hutchinson's, like in syphilis, we also have some more findings. In more findings, we can see that we have a mulberry molars. As we can see in these molars, we have like mulberry like appearance. So mulberry. So here I'm going to write the other findings. Other findings for syphilis. So it include the mulberry molars. The second one, that is a Clutton's joint. Also we can see Higamonsky sign. Please remember this already asked in the PGI questions, so PGI exam. So Higamonsky sign, and the third one, that is a, there is recurrent abortion. So if they ask which infection shows the recurrent abortion, so the syphilis causes the recurrent abortions. So we have to now, for the image memory, we have to remember this image, that it shows a mulberry appearance. So mulberry molars will seen in the syphilis. This is a mulberry molars. Now the next one, that is the Clutton's joint. In Clutton's joint, as we see this image, these were the Clutton's joint. So Clutton's joint, it is also seen in the syphilis. Now the third one, that is, this one is the Higamonsky sign. What do we mean by the Higamonsky sign? Basically, in Higamonsky sign, first I will write that Higamonsky sign. So in Higamonsky sign, what will be there? That there is like in the medial of the cranial, in the medial of the clavicle, there is calcification is there, which indicate that it is a Higamonsky sign. So this one is the Higamonsky sign. Now the that one, all these were the other findings for the syphilis. Now how we can do the diagnosis, how we can make diagnosis of syphilis? For the diagnosis of syphilis, we have to do immunoglobulin M, FTA, ABS, that is immunoglobulin fluorescent troponemal antibody absorption test. So we have to do this test, and it also previous year question. Please remember, for the syphilis diagnosis, we have to do immunoglobulin FTA ABS test. Now how we are going to treat this patient? So for the treatment of the syphilis, what we have to do? We have to give the parenteral penicillin G. Parenteral penicillin G is given, and for the prenatal screening for syphilis, we have to identify the prenatal screening. We have to do the prenatal screening for the syphilis, because if the patient is untreated, if the fetus is untreated, then there will be 100% mortality will be there. So we have to do the prenatal screening. Prenatal screening for syphilis we have to do, because if it is untreated, then there will be 100% mortality. 100% mortality will be there. Now, the next one, that is the varicella. So for the Higamonsky sign, as I already told you, there is the thickening of the medial portion of the clavicle. That is the Higamonsky sign. Please remember, it is seen in the syphilis. Now the next one, in others also, O stands for others, in which we already covered the syphilis, and the other one, that is the varicella zoster virus. So varicella, congenital varicella syndrome, that is a varicella is a chicken pox. It is a chicken pox. So in this varicella we seen a limb hypoplasia. We see that the child has limb hypoplasia. There is cicatricial skin lesions will be there, and there is history of fever with rash. The mother will give the history that the child has fever with rash in the end of first second trimester. Now what else we can see in the varicella syndrome? We see that three organs involvement, that is the CNS involvement, the eyes involvement, and the kidney involvement. The CNS involvement, the eyes involvement, and there is a kidney involvement. There is a kidney involvement. So in the CNS involvement, what we can see microcephaly, we can see microcephaly, we can see seizures, and we can see the mental retardation will be there. While for the eye involvement, we see chorioretinitis, which we already see in the toxoplasma. So in this also we see the chorioretinitis, the microphthalmia, the eyes were small, microphthalmia. And renal and kidney problem, we see the hydronephrosis. We see hydronephrosis. So all these findings for the varicella. So there is, as we see in this image, there is limb hypoplasia. There is limb hypoplasia. We can see limb hypoplasia. And in this image, we already see that there is a rash. The child has fever with rash. Now the next one, we also have to know that how we can diagnose. So for the diagnosis of varicella, we have to anti-VZV antibodies. We have to check anti-VZV varicella zoster virus antibodies. We have to check. Now the next one, TOR. R stands for the rubella. So for the rubella, congenital rubellic syndrome, this is the most severe form. Please remember, it is a most severe form during the intrauterine infection, and it occurs in the first trimester. Intrauterine infection. Now rubella presentation is same as like measles rash, but in this the rash appear on day one. Please remember that rash appear on day one and lasts for 3 days. So that's why rubella is also known as 3-day measles. So it is also known as 3-day measles, because in this the rash appear on day one and the rash will last for only 3 days. Well, in the measles, that in that one the rash fever with rash on day four, that's why that one is a measles on day four. While for the rubella, day 1-3, that why it is known as 3-day measles. Now what were the findings we can see in the rubella? So the for the findings we can see microcephaly. We can see the ocular, means eye involvement will be there, and in ocular we see a salt and pepper retinopathy. Please remember, salt and pepper retinopathy. So salt and pepper retinopathy we see in the rubella, and also in the skin lesions. In skin lesions, what we see a blueberry muffin appearance. Blueberry muffin appearance we see in the rubella. So these three findings we are seeing. Now just look at the images. So in this we can see salt and pepper chromatin, salt and pepper retinopathy. So this indicates the salt and pepper retinopathy. So this indicates the salt and pepper retinopathy. While in this image we see a blueberry muffin appearance will be there. So in this we see blueberry muffin appearance. So blueberry muffin appearance we see in this image. Also in this, how we can do the diagnosis. So for the diagnosis, before diagnosis we also have to study the Greg stride, that is most important for the rubella. The Greg triad. So in the Greg triad, we have CCD. We have CCD. Now in this C, C and D. D for deafness, there is deafness will be there, like sensory neural hearing loss will be there. C, another C stands for congenital heart defect. In that one, we have patent ductus arteriosus. And the other one, C for eye cataract, that is nuclear cataract. In this, we see a nuclear cataract in the rubella syndrome. So these were the findings, and in this, like most common, there is deafness. So most common out of the Greg triad, most common is sensory neural hearing loss, that is the deafness. The other finding other than the triad, we also have the spots, that is Forchheimer spots, that is Forchheimer spots. These were the red spot over the palate, which we see in the rubella infection. So please remember, it is seen in rubella infection, not in the syndrome. So it is seen in rubella infection, not in syndrome. So as we see these Forchheimer spots, we can see these were the red spots over the hard palate. On the hard palate, we can see, not on the soft palate, the hard palate. So Forchheimer spots also seen in the rubella syndrome. Now how we can diagnose? So we, for the diagnosis of rubella, we can check the immunoglobulin antibody serum in fetal blood. We can check. So this one is the diagnosis of the rubella. Now the next infection, that is the cytomegalovirus infection. So cytomegalovirus infection, this is the most common, as I already told you, it is a most common congenital infection, most common congenital infections. And how, what were the findings? So all the findings were same as of the toxoplasma, but here one difference is there, that is the characteristic difference. Because in the toxoplasma, we see the diffuse intracranial calcification, but here we will find periventricular calcification, means around the ventricle, we are finding the calcification. So periventricular calcification, we will see. And on the long-term complication, we also find that for long-term complication, we see hearing loss. Now, how we will diagnose and treatment? For the diagnosis of cytomegalovirus, we have to do cytomegalovirus PCR test. The best sample for this is, this one is also a previous year question, the best sample is urine. Best sample is urine for cytomegalovirus. And saliva is used in newborn screening test. Newborn screening test. Now how we will treat it? The cytomegalovirus, the treatment is Jancyclovir and Valganciclovir. So all these were the treatment for the cytomegalovirus, that is Jancyclovir and Valganciclovir. Now the last one, that is a herpes. So in this one, as we see here, these were the intracranial calcification, means calcification we only see around the ventricle. So these were the intraventricular calcification. Now the last one, that is the herpes one. So in the herpes, now the herpes virus, in herpes we have to see a three form of disease we can see in the herpes. The first one is the skin, the eye and the mouth disease. Skin, eye and mouth disease we see in the herpes. Now how we can prevent the herpes infection? So for the prevention of herpes, we can do elastic C-section. And for the treatment of the herpes, what we have to do? So for the treatment of herpes, we can keep the intravenous acyclovir. This is the treatment for herpes. Now this is the image in which we see the rashes will be there, and it involves the skin, eyes and mouth disease. So that's all for the torch infection. I hope this video will be very helpful for you for preparing your exams. Thank you. Bye bye guys.